I would very much like to thank Professor Gülru Necipoğlu and Professor Roxburgh for giving me this opportunity, and also to Cecily Pollard, who is always very kind. I'm very happy to be here and here today, and many thanks to all of you for coming. Before I begin to discuss my research, I would very shortly like to introduce my previous work. So this is my natural habitat. I have been teaching both architectural design and urban history, yet in both cases, my focus has always been on the integration of landscape culture into the understanding and construction of spaces, along with the construction of self and identity. My research in Ottoman garden and landscape culture is linked inevitably to the urban culture and history of Istanbul, yet at times my studio carried me outside the city. For example, at the Aegean mountain village of Çomak'ta, I examined the vernacular female body with respect to the vernacular landscape traditions. And even sometimes out of context, design enables to practice forms one comes across in history. And this I put for you, Jim, because this is in another town at the Aegean coast. I have designed a çadır, or a çadar. Back in Istanbul, here at these two alternatives of the many, gardens propose to unfold and conceal the geometric relationships between architecture and open spaces at Beyazıt Square. I know some of you told me that you were expecting me to talk on my book. The content of today's presentation is not central to the book, where I examined urban rituals through Şehrengiz poetry from the 16th to the early 18th century, which proposed an understanding of an in-between space called the barzak, mainly by those poets who, in the words of Abdülbaki Gölpınarlı, relished melami joy, a specific mystic philosophy, where each time barzak enabled the multiplicity of self-expression in diverse open spaces. And as such joy continued to be practiced in the early 18th century, I proposed for the existing of a thematic in-between garden at the famous recreational space of Kağıthane, designed to be the paradise on earth, the Garden of İram. And later, I looked into the possible design of gardens at Kağıthane accompanying the palace, and further the contemporary use of the site. Yet in each case, whether historical or contemporary, I tried to examine the mutual construction of landscape and self, or the efforts to, or their mutual destruction. It's not always pretty dealing with gardens. There's always blood. And unfortunately, there is a tradition of destroying gardens throughout the history, and even more so recently. At this instant, I would like to thank, when I have the opportunity, to Professor Kafadar for his inspirational works, which have a lot of influence in the shaping of my framework. So with a similar framework, tonight I would like to tell a story about two gardens from the 16th century Ottoman Istanbul, represented in two different mediums. The first garden is actually a paper cut garden, a decoupage or cut, in other words. The second garden we learn about through textual evidence, mainly from Aşık Çelebi's Meşair-i Şuara or the biography of poets. The first one is an image, a garden representation, most probably crafted by an artist called Efşancı Mehmet. For example, as Felix Çağman proposes, and accepted likewise by the scholarship. The other one is a real garden that we learn about from historical narratives, a garden which belongs to the artist Efşancı Mehmet. So they are both gardens of Efşancı, and supposedly they belong to a certain Efşancı Mehmet, or we don't know. So we don't know if the crafted garden is a representation of the existing one, and I believe that there is not enough evidence, and we don't know for sure if both gardens actually belong to the same person, Efşancı Mehmet. Yet what we know for certain is that both are gardens of the early 16th century, and both are products of the same circle. The paper cut garden was collaged within an album dated to the last quarter of the 16th century, around 1560. And being compiled into an album, the garden is surrounded by calligraphic work with verses from the Ottoman poets Mesihi and Baki. David Roxburgh mentions in the last chapter of his book, the Persian album from dispersal to collection to this album, and he defines the contents of the album made out of 46 folios in total, majority being calligraphic works depicting poetry and religious accounts. The calligraphic works mainly belongs to Shah Mahmud al-Nishapuri, who formerly worked in the Safavid court under Shah Tahmasp, and Karamemi was also who was also working in the imperial workshops in 1550s, was one of the artists among other Persian luminaries. In his biography of the poets, completed in 1568, Aşık Çelebi talks both about the artistry of Efşancı Mehmet as a paper cutter and also as a gardener, who had gained fame at the time of Sultan Süleyman. He died around 1535 to 36, and scholarship assumes that the paper cut garden belongs to his mastery, and it is roughly dated to his just before to his death, 1535 to 36. So apparently the paper cut garden was included in the album at a later date than its execution and pasted on a new folio with poetic verses collaged surrounding the image. The diversity of dates and multiplicity of artists, including poetic verses from Mesihi and Baki, create a chaotic yet challenging scenery. What I would like to suggest is that juxtaposition of multiple layers of references to different authors and to various dates actually proposes common values shared and practiced among its actors. I would again like to refer to David as he uses the special metaphor of the site for the Persian albums, where images and practices of a shared culture were acting upon. Likewise, on this simple page, different practices of a shared culture of arts of calligraphy, poetry, and as well as gardens, encounter one another in a dialogue enjoyed throughout the 16th century Ottoman Istanbul. So let's return to our garden representation. This paper cut garden that extends on an area of approximately 180 square centimeters or 28 square inches is attributed to be a work of Efşancı Mehmet, the paper cutter. It's a garden representation made out of cut papers of various colors, planted with cypresses, blooming fruit trees, and colorful flowers. It appears disorganized and wild. Rose bushes with flowers of varying colors in bloom climb upwards and encircle the trees and dazzle the eyes. Despite the fact that the representation of the garden seems to follow no order at first sight, it encloses a very complex arrangement of trees. The order is maintained by the type, size, color, and location of the trees and flowers. The center is regulated by a small cypress tree. Two of the cypresses which seem to govern the composition at first sight are symmetric with respect to an unseen axis, but this axis is actually shifted from the axis of the page that is governed by the small cypress tree. So the whole composition is a complex organization of games of symmetry and asymmetry. Trees in bloom, rose bushes, flowers further complicate the simple vertical appearance of the cypress trees. Blooming trees are planted in between couples of cypresses. The vision achieves complexity on purpose. This calls to mind Gülru Necipoğlu's seminal work, The Topkapı Scroll, where she discusses the concept of iman-ı nazar, the willful complication of vision. As discussed by Necipoğlu, perception is ordered according to three levels, following Ibn Haytham: pure sensation, glancing perception, and contemplative perception. Pure sensation is described as the sensual cognition of light and color. It involves sensual faculties. Glancing perception is cognition by remembrance. It involves the mind and the memory. Contemplative perception involves imaginative faculties that enable seeing beyond the apparent form of the object and contemplating to its novel qualities which the mind or the memory cannot recognize and the eye cannot distinguish. Contemplative perception required subject's involvement. It valued the individual taste of the subject and defined beauty of the object contemplated as subjective and contextual. Complication of vision was an affirmative quality accomplished on purpose. Necipoğlu argues that Islamic decorative arts made use of such optic doctrines and created complicated patterns that required contemplation of the individual and triggered imaginative faculties. As Necipoğlu claims that such complication of vision was a willful effort of the artist, I would also like to claim that the complexity of this garden design was achieved on purpose. In parallel, the garden, as it appears to be disorderly at first sight, actually unfolds its complex order in time through contemplation. This threesome ordering of perception discussed in the Topkapı Scroll is also parallel to Ibn Arabi's classification of cognitive faculties. Ibn Arabi discusses three different types of faculties, three levels of cognition for the attainment of knowledge. These are sensual, intellectual, and imaginative faculties. The first one, the sensual cognition, the most deprived and inferior faculty among the three, is empowered by the five senses of the human body and activated by the soul. It is not limited to vision, but includes all kinds of desireful appetites that the human body possesses. Contrary to other Islamic scholars, Arabi argues that all appetite is necessary as it shapes the initial step in cognition. Second one, intellectual cognition, is activated by the mind through rational thinking and memory, enables to understand the world by way of learned associations linked to the hadiths and the Quran mainly. The third one is the faculty of imagination. Arabi considers the imaginative faculty superior to the other two faculties. It is portrayed as a divine state of inspiration towards the understanding and realization of absolute and true knowledge. It is creative in the sense that it offers the contemplation of new meanings, new forms, every time the imagination is activated. Arabi also defines the space, the realm where imagination takes place. Because imagination is the meeting of forms and ideas, this space is a place of encounter. In the realm of imagination, a part of the divine knowledge descends where it meets with the ascending form that has lost its density. These spaces of encounter, which are dynamic and ever-changing, coexist at different levels of existence, namely cosmography, and they are called barzakh. So barzakh is an in-between intermediary space, and the attainment of knowledge at its highest level takes place within the diversity of these in-between spaces. So the concept of barzakh embodies an understanding of both and instead of either or. The presence of barzakh enables the coexistence of ontology and epistemology. So far, it enabled metaphysical and physical worlds as equally important, and actually portrays the significance of the individual self as equal to God. Arabi discusses barzakh having special qualities as a space, and most importantly, as a garden. And this garden is portrayed as a place to see the truth. The garden is a veil between the subject and God, the only place where the vision of God himself is available as reflected upon this veil. At this point, the realm of imagination becomes almost like a virtual space, a virtual garden or an imaginary screen, where the subject as the viewer tries to identify the forms on the screen with respect to his selective will, with regards to his appetite. So form meets essence in a garden, the essence that is going to join the form for a single moment during the act of imagination descends from heavens in the form of light. So this illumination made possible by traveling light, and it also illuminates the garden which had already been surrounding the world. This ever-present garden is perceived only by those who are able to imagine. According to Arabi again, the multiplicity of different kinds of gardens on earth all refer to the original paradise garden. Thus, contemplation of any garden would reveal knowledge about the paradise. Henry Corbin argues that in Arabi's perspective, unfolding of knowledge is activated and communicated by metaphors. He says communication through metaphors is possible because beyond the multiplicity of the apparent world, the whole universe is sustained in unity, which speaks a common language. That reality is the knowledge of God, bestowed to all the participants of the universe. This common ground enables sympathy and attraction between things and enables their communication. Thus, through metaphors, poetry triggers imagination. If you look at a Persian example from Sultan Ibrahim Mirza's Haftavrang of the 16th century, the poet attains divine knowledge by revelation through angelic illumination here in a garden. On the door of the garden pavilion where the poet Sadi is composing a new poem, it is written, "Gardens of Eden, whereof the gates are opened for them." And the garden is depicted to bring angels and common people together enjoying a garden party. So poetry also enables the juxtaposition of different layers of the cosmic order. Poetry, cited in gardens, then actually presents an ideal setting for cognition, where, in the words of Ibn Arabi, the pool of imagination, or the market of the garden, unfolds to be contemplated in front of the ones who aim to attain divine knowledge. And returning back to our garden, it makes much more sense that the physical garden, the real one, of Efşancı Mehmet, is actually described in the biography of poets. Aşık Çelebi describes the private garden of Efşancı Mehmet. It was famous for garden parties frequently visited by the elite, including Sultan Süleyman and his vizier Damat İbrahim Paşa. Aşık Çelebi, from whom we learn a quite deal about the gardens we will refer tonight, refers to him as the master of paper cutting. He mentions that calligraphers envied his paper cut letters, while florists resented his beautifully cut flowers. Efşancı had a very quick hand. He used to cut violets in tens. He was also very quick in writing, that Aşık Çelebi tells he had written the whole manuscript of Hüsrev-i Şirin, a mesnevi of 7,000 verses in one night before presenting it to Beyazıt II. However, when Efşancı Mehmet's health deteriorated due to a kind of arthritis, and when he was not able to enjoy the extraordinary skills of his masterful hand, he came to employ his talents in creating a real garden, which Aşık Çelebi mentions as the Efşancı Garden, as a garden of İram, a paradise on earth. His garden was so much adored and appreciated that he turned out to be a rival to his own mastery in creating gardens of paper. Efşancı Garden was planted with cypresses, peach trees, quince, plum, boxes, hyacinth, narcissus, jasmine, basil, and even with water lilies. Interestingly, Aşık Çelebi also notes that Efşancı was an inventor, that he used to call each flower with original names, with an original name, and also he used to trade them. He was known to pay large amounts for special bulbs. Along with the garden of Efşancı, there are other gardens that we learn about from Aşık Çelebi in his biography of poets. One of these gardens is the garden of Sirkeci Bahşi, who decided to quit his scholarly pursuits after a frightening experience during an earthquake and settled in a garden for the rest of his remaining life, a garden which turned out to be a gathering space of poets hosting garden parties and poetic rituals referred as İşret Mahalli or Sohbetgah. It was frequently visited by the scholars, high-ranking officials, wise and mystic poets, but his doors were closed to the ordinary from the lower ranks. Aşık Çelebi notes that this garden was located at Beşiktaş and was beautiful as paradise. Apart from his interest in beauty and beautiful young beloveds, Sirkeci Bahşi was a terrific host and an acknowledged cook. Fruits from his garden, especially apples, peaches, quinces, pomegranates, figs, cherries, and small sweet melons were delicious. In addition to vinegar, the garden came to be famous for its pickles as a hangover remedy, cultivated and produced within a portion of his bigger garden, and sold in large quantities to the Navy soldiers. Thus, his garden was also famous among the tavern goers and the taverners. And another garden acknowledged by Aşık Çelebi is the Karabağlı Garden, again a significant garden for bringing beloved ones and poets, yet different from Sirkeci Bahşi, that it hosted people from all ranks. Populated by and a busy garden for a diverse crowd with high-ranking officials and common people, experts of every guild, those who employed a joyful mastery of their professions, homeless drunks, together with acclaimed friends from the lands of the Arabs, or Arabs and Persia, as Aşık Çelebi tells us. Karabağlı Garden was on the European side of the city in the province of Beşiktaş, probably in Fındıklı, surrounded by vineyards and other gardens. Archival documents enlisted the existence of the garden from the 16th to the 18th centuries. However, it is known to survive its glory days as a pleasure garden at the time of the three 16th century sultans, Süleyman, Selim and Murat. Among many other travelers, Solomon Schweiger gives a lot of information about the garden. He was able to enter and visit this private garden by bribing gardeners, which was then a common practice among most of the foreign travelers. He translates the name of the Karabali as the Garden of the Black King and describes the garden in detail. He also provides a plan, as you see here. And as we can see in this drawing, the garden was circular in plan. It was surrounded by two rows of cypress trees. According to Schweiger, cypresses were as high as Christmas trees. In between each pair of cypresses, there were rosemary bushes grown up to half of a man's height. The garden housed three pavilions, one open belvedere in front of a small swimming pool, another latticed and tiled, and the third one for the gardeners. And in the Karabali garden, he lists various fruit trees and plants, pomegranates, lemons, figs, mulberries, apples, pears, and melons. As Aşık Çelebi informs the assemblies hosted in the garden of Karabali, they would begin at dawn, the guests would be at ease, feel free and comfortable without the imposing restrictions of garden parties that we observe elsewhere. Unrestricted, those who would like were able to lay down, incline and relax, and even act as deaf if they wanted to do so. Yet there was never grief or sorrow in these parties. Private garden parties enjoyed by all ranks of the society usually took place at nights lit by moonlight, candles or lanterns, and continued until sunrise. Musicians played music and sang songs. Perfumes were used to enrich the atmosphere. These intimate parties were enjoyed by close friends. Fruits and dishes were served, such as chestnut, walnut, almond, pistachio, hazelnut, cherry, plum, fig, strawberries, melon, watermelon, apple, peach, fish eggs, fish pickles, pastrami, maybe we are hungry all, lobster, mussels, sardine, cheese and kebab varieties. Wine of different kinds, red wine, aged wine, dark red wine, rose wine, was among the major servings. In this image, Kanuni and his son Mustafa are depicted in a garden assembly. In the background lies a green meadow and hills planted with trees and flowers. They are seated at an elevated pavilion, looking at a fountain, listening to the musicians. The location of the fountain and the musicians is noteworthy in this image, as it suggests that the sound of music, the sound of water, and most probably, sounds of nature must be expected to blend into one another to be appreciated and contemplated by the audience. We can see comparable setups in different gardens, and even in this contemporary example that you see on the right, there is a similar arrangement which is achieved without intention. The Ottoman poet Ayni describes the order of a private party. He acknowledges that parties took place in every season. With changing seasons and climatic conditions, the location of the parties would change from open spaces to indoors. He states that first the drinking cups would be arranged and then the participants would arrive. The participants would converse and cite poems while listening to the music and enjoying the servings. And the party would last until sunshine. Ayni mentions that all the participants were expected to know how to behave in a party. There were certain manners to be followed. The guests would kneel down, sitting on their heels. Unlike in the Garden of Karabali, guests were expected to sit straight. They were not allowed to support their bodies, bend, or rest. They were not allowed to bend their heads downwards, cough, sneeze, yawn, or stretch. The guests were not supposed to hold wine cups for a long time. It was not tolerable to display emotional states in extremes. It was not tolerable to cry, to display anger or discontent. So garden parties actually displayed vivid images of the Ottoman cultural life. Walter Andrews presents that private gardens were central to the Ottoman poetic tradition, especially to the gazelle. And noteless in his biography of poets, Aşık Çelebi gives us almost all the information about these gardens we mentioned. We came across the persona of Karabali in many instances of poetic gatherings through Aşık Çelebi, as he narrates the biographies of various poets, and in each case, Karabali listens to the sorrows and personal anxieties of other poets, usually in a garden, listens to Figani's nightmare, another one's economic poverty, Kandi becoming a destitute. One can even argue that, apart from all the horticultural activities and cultivation of a diversity of trees and flowers, these gardens became a locus not only for garden gatherings, but also spaces for the sustainability of poetic circles. A similar garden belonged to Aşki, was located in Üsküdar, and others can further be added. Yet if we return back to the representation of the so-called Efşancı garden, supposedly a garden party takes place through the gentle darkness of the night after the assembly of guests and the host gather at dawn. In another album in Vienna, there is the representation of similar gardens to that of our paper cut garden, which is also attributed to the mastery of Efşancı Mehmet. In the simpler version of garden depictions, one can take as practices on the way to accomplish the complexity of the example we are questioning, it is even more obvious that a garden is depicted in two phases, under sunlight and at night. So through the darkness of the night in the Efşancı garden, we can propose that once the eye, which was perplexed through the seemingly chaotic order of the setting, where in addition the sound of music, water, and probably birds, drinks, fruits, and food, stimulate the desire, all addressing to the appetites of the desireful body, further complicating perception, through contemplation, all terms of appetite turn out to be agencies to unfold the complex order of the garden. And in accord, as poetry triggers imagination further, when the flowers and blooming trees of the spring from Mesih's and Baki's verses respond to one another, Judas trees, cypresses, plane trees, roses, carnations, tulips, lilies from Baki's poem mix between those within the garden in blossom, the heart begins to unravel the mystery of the garden and the geometry of the planting of trees with dynamic shifting axes only adds up to this complexity for the guests to unfold on their journey through the night. If such gardens like those of Efşancı existed, we certainly don't know. We can certainly define flowers that exist in the paper cut garden of Efşancı when we look into other sources of the 16th century for naturalistic depictions, and certainly these types correspond to the ones illustrated in the narrative accounts where the real garden is described. Even though we know that it was a common tradition to plant flowering trees, bushes or ivies in between cypresses or accompanying cypresses, we can assert that we cannot point out to any Ottoman gardens having such an ordered layout. Except for the accounts of Evliya Çelebi from 17th century, where he tells us about planting trees in grids or in chessboard patterns, and further gives us information for layered plants where flowering trees are planted in between cypresses. Whether the real Efşancı garden carried out such a complex geometry or not, I would like to ask if this garden representation with verses celebrating spring added to it at a later date actually proposes for an ideal of gardens that was shared, practiced, or desired in the 16th century Ottoman Istanbul. Or can we assume that even in the image of a single flower, the Ottoman mind was trained to contemplate and imagine the ideal of the paradise, whether a rare tulip or a humble cultivation was able or is able to trigger the imagination. And as an end note, I have to say, yesterday when I presented my paper to my 7-year-old son, he said, "Yes, Mom, it's nice, but it's really not about architecture. It's more about life." So I'm open to all questions and comments. And please consider this as the early stages of a research in the life of the 16th century Ottoman gardens. Thank you.